10 days ago, the United Arab Emirates became the third Arab nation to normalize relations with Israel. The signing of the so-called Abraham Accord took many by surprise. So did this revelation this week that there was a White House push to sell F-35 stealth fighter jets to the Emirates. CNN and many other outlets report that that push and the push for the agreement itself was led by my guest. Jared Kushner is a senior advisor to President Trump, who is also his father-in-law. Jared Kushner, welcome on the show.
Thank you, Fareed. It's an honor to be with you today.
So let me ask you, the president tasked you with a peace deal that was meant to be a peace deal between Israel and the Palestinians. That is the ultimate goal, I still assume. And I, in that context, was wondering, this seems like a great deal for Bibi Netanyahu. He has gotten this extraordinary concession, the normalization of relations with the UAE, and had to give up nothing. He announced an annexation plan, floated an annexation plan, which never happened, and then withdrew it, which seems like a brilliant bargaining strategy. So, in a sense, didn't he outsmart you? And if he gets rewards for not doing anything, why will he make peace with the Palestinians? What is the incentive to make peace with the Palestinians if he's getting all these things without making peace with the Palestinians?
Yeah, so first of all, Fareed, I'd say that this peace deal, which is the third peace deal in 70 years for Israel and the first peace deal in the Middle East in the last 26 years, is a big win for the whole world, not just for Israel. It's a win for the United Arab Emirates. It's a win for America. And quite frankly, in the region, it's a big win for all of the countries who want to see their societies advance, who want to see their people brought together in a society of tolerance around economic opportunity. And it's about people wanting to push back on the people who are looking to radicalize the region and use these old conflicts as a way to sow disconnection. The last time I was on your show, we were talking about President Trump's vision for peace, where we got Israel to make historic concessions that they hadn't been willing to agree to in a long time. We laid out a 180-page document, which was a blueprint for peace between the Israelis and the Palestinians. It really showed you had Israel agreeing to a Palestinian state, and it was the first time in history that Israel agreed to a map, which was based on the facts on the ground. You know, we have a practical background. We went in, we listened to all the different sides, and we were able to come up with what we thought a rational framework was for a final negotiated settlement. Once we put that out, that showed a lot of the different people in the Arab world that Israel was indeed serious about making peace with the Palestinians. And a lot of the relations that we'd been stimulating over the last years were able to come to the forefront. So this was a great breakthrough. You know, negotiations are different. The Middle East is obviously a complicated place. We had a lot of people who doubted that our efforts would bear fruit. But this peace deal is a great vindication for all of the unorthodox steps that President Trump has taken over the last 3.5 years in one of the most complicated regions in the world. And I will say that this is obviously a big step forward, but I believe that it will be another turning point in the region that will lead to more prosperity, more shared opportunity, and hopefully more peace and stability for the long term.
So I understand what Israel gets from it, and now it appears, if the reports are correct, the UAE is getting the F-35, which is something they've long wanted, have not been granted before. Is it true that you are pushing that sale take place, and when will it take place?
Yeah, so this has become an issue that I guess came up maybe as a political issue in Israel over the last week or so. But the UAE's been trying to get the F-35 for a long time. The group that wants them not to get it the most is obviously Iran, because they're right across the Strait of Hormuz from there. And the reality is that this new peace agreement should increase the probability of them getting it. But it's something we're reviewing. Obviously, we'll look at the QME, and we'll do everything in accordance with the right standards. But it's something that the State Department and the U.S. military is looking at. But the UAE has been a tremendous military partner for America for many years. And so this is something that we could see potentially happening now as a result of this great breakthrough.
Let me ask you, before we get to the campaign, Jared, would you predict that by November, Saudi Arabia and Bahrain will also have normalized relations with Israel?
So I don't want to make any predictions. I think right now I'm going to be traveling to the region. We want to make sure that we cement this agreement in place. We want to make sure this is a very warm peace. There's tons of doctors who want to start working together on coronavirus together. We have a lot of trade and tourism that want to happen. We want to get this embedded as quickly as possible. But what I will say is that a lot of people around the region are looking at the tremendous economic opportunities that will now exist for the UAE as a hub for Israeli business to the rest of the Arab world, and they want to make this happen too. So I do think there'll be a lot of countries that will want to follow behind, but obviously this is the first one in 26 years. The rest will come at their pace, but I wouldn't be surprised if others go soon.
So let me ask you about November. Clearly the big issue is going to be the pandemic and the handling of the pandemic. And the facts are pretty clear. The United States has 5% of the world's population, 25% of the world's cases, the world's leader. It has a death rate, COVID death rate, of 15 to 20 times higher than the European Union or Canada. The testing system we have in place, Bill Gates says, is the most worthless in the world because of the long test times. And he argues it is entirely because of the federal government and its unwillingness to change. That sounds like a tough record to run on.
Yeah, well, again, it's hard to disagree with Bill Gates because he's had a big success, but I do disagree with him here. If you look at the amount of tests we've done more than any other country by a big factor. We've been able to enable the supplies and get it out to the government.
But his whole point is those tests are worthless because you are infectious for 2 or 3 days around when you have symptoms. And if you get the test results 4, 5, 6 days later, which is the average for the United States, they're essentially worthless.
Yeah, the average is now down to about 2.3 days, and the reality is that testing is a strategic tool. Testing is not a panacea, and if we've been utilizing the fast tests that we have to really protect the vulnerable, and our case fatality rate is much lower than anyone else, and if you look at the U.S. versus Europe, and you look at excess mortality rate, we're below Europe. So, look, we also have a lot of considerations. We've managed this way through where we've taken care of all the different groups that needed. We've gotten the PPE to the frontline workers. We've gotten the ventilators to everyone who needed. And we've ramped up the largest amount of testing of anyone in the world. And so, obviously, we have 50 different CEOs and the governors. Some of them have done a better job than others, but our job has been to get them the supplies, to give them the guidance, to share ideas across the way. We've also developed a lot of therapeutics, which have been helping keep our case fatality down. And today, I think we're going to have another great announcement on that. And if you look at the vaccine, we've also the fastest vaccine ever to a phase three trial was 13 months. We did it in 4 for the first one, and we have 3 in phase three that we're simultaneously developing. So we're going to get to the other end of it. And I do think that out of this, some countries are going to get stronger, some countries will get weaker. With the work that President Trump's done to save our economy coming out of this, I believe we have an opportunity to bring a lot of our jobs back on shore, to emerge as a real globally dominant player, much bigger than before. And if we slow down and we do it in a different way, we could lose a lot of ground to the world. So, you know, obviously this is a once in a 100-year pandemic. You know, there's a lot of different challenges that have arisen. We've done very well meeting most of those. And I do believe that we're going to rise from this much stronger thanks to the president's leadership.
But the public doesn't seem to agree. The last time you were on the show, you were feeling pretty good because you said the president had an approval rating around 46-47%, the Real Clear Politics average. That approval rating is down to 43.7%, with 54% disapproving. Those are pretty tough numbers. And what is the president's strategy to turn those around?
Yeah, so first of all, he was at, I think, at about 37 when he won, so he's still above where he was last time. Look, because of the pandemic, a lot of the country's been distracted. I think these conventions are a real kickoff. We saw the Democrats last week have a very dark vision for America. You were talking about the great diversity earlier of their party, but a lot of those Republicans are not, I mean, those are people who are Washington elites, a lot of insiders, people who have, you know, made their lives and their careers off of Washington. President Trump represents the American people. He's the outsider president, and I think you're going to see a very hopeful vision for America that he's going to be unleashing. You're going to see a real diversity of the Republican Party that he's built. You're going to see it's going to be different than how the media tells you. And unlike the Democrats last week, where there was a lot of complaints, they didn't offer much by way of policy or solutions. President Trump will be laying out, you know, real policies, real visions, real solutions for how he brings our country back and makes it stronger than ever before. So we feel really good about where we are. Again, the media misjudged the the president's chance of winning last time. A lot of the public polling misjudged the president's chances last time. We feel like we're in a substantially better position now than we were 4 years ago, and we're quite excited about the convention coming up this week and the campaign that will ensue after that.